Hey everybody, I'm Aaron Simmons. This is Philosophy for Where We Find Ourselves, May 28th, 2020. The darkness of the ambiance actually fits what I want to discuss with you today. And that is the lament that we should be showing as a nation, as individuals. And in particular, I want to speak to white Christians and the expectation that lament should be the mode of our lives in light of the continued realities of racial oppression, white supremacy, and the power relations that attend the sin of whiteness. Now, in order to think about this, rather than me just giving you a bunch of my thoughts, what I want to do is let you instead hear the words, the ideas, the truth of two thinkers, James Cone and Martin Luther King Jr. So to begin, let me read you some from James Cone in his book, The Cross and the Lynching Tree. The cross can heal and hurt. It can be empowering and liberating, but also enslaving and oppressive. There is no one way in which the cross can be interpreted. I offer my reflections because I believe that the cross placed alongside the lynching tree can help us to see Jesus in America in a new light, and thereby empower people who claim to follow him to take a stand against white supremacy and every kind of injustice. Now notice Cone here makes clear that Christian life is not simply an abstraction from our concrete existence, nor is it a divine escape plan for abandoning the human condition. It is instead a thoroughgoing investment, an outpouring of ourselves in the bodily situation of others. And he continues to then say, and yet the Christian gospel is more than a transcendent reality, more than going to heaven when I die to shout salvation as I fly. It is also an imminent reality, a powerful, liberating presence among the poor right now in their midst, building them up where they are torn down and propping them up on every leaning side. The gospel is found wherever poor people struggle for justice, fighting for their right to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Cone here reminds us that what it is to live as a Christian is not simply to sign a faith statement or affirm a set of propositions about the divine. It is to live a life activated by the example of Christ. It is to be a Christ follower, which means to eschew power, to run from the temptations of the status quo, and instead to become invested in the concrete well-being of others. Turning to Martin Luther King Jr., one of the important things about the way that MLK approached his conception of racial justice was that he anchored it in the importance of speaking truth to power, in that prophetic tradition that understood God calls us to speak out when there is in fact injustice, because that is heresy to the eschatological vision described by Christ and that we should model in the world. For King, he was very frustrated that white Christians, in particular white moderate Christians, continued to be an obstacle and a stumbling block because of their refusal to empower justice for others, even though in name they would send thoughts and prayers. When it came down to the hard work of social change, they seemed to have other things that were more important to do. Listen to King's rebuke of that approach. In spite of my shattered dreams of the past, I came to Birmingham with the hope that the white religious leadership of this community would see the justice of our cause, and with deep moral concern, serve as the channel through which our just grievances would get to the power structure. I had hoped that each of you would understand, but again I have been disappointed. I have heard numerous religious leaders of the South call upon their worshipers to comply with desegregation decisions because it is the law. But I have longed to hear white ministers say, follow this decree because integration is morally right and the Negro is your brother. In the midst of blatant injustices inflicted upon the Negro, I have watched white churches stand on the sidelines and merely mouth pious irrelevancies and sanctimonious trivialities. In the midst of a mighty struggle to rid our nation of racial and economic injustice, I have heard so many ministers say, those are social issues with which the gospel has no real concern. and I have watched so many churches commit themselves to a completely otherworldly religion, which made a strange distinction between body and soul, the sacred and the secular. So here we are moving toward the exit of the 20th century with a religious community largely adjusted to the status quo, standing as a taillight behind other community agencies rather than a headlight leading men to higher levels of justice. May we now, 20 years into the 21st century, begin to become that headlight, to refuse the complacency, the callousness, the indifference, the escapism, and the apathy that defines so much of white Christian response to racial and economic injustice. May we all develop ears to hear the words of King and Cone, and then may we work together to develop hands that can actually transform the society in light of it. I'll see you tomorrow, unless a piano falls on our hands.